Annalisa, thank you so much for being here today. I never knew I would have an opportunity to interview someone or talk to someone about how to write a book, because I do have one up there. I don't know that it'll ever see the light of day, so I'm glad to know there's people like you who can help some of us. How did you get into doing this?
Yeah, so I really love what I do. I'm able to help people to tell their stories every single day. It's a passion of mine to help all people tell their stories and tell them well. So I hope that your book gets out into the world so that we can all enjoy your story. I think that all of our voices together tell a beautiful story of humanity. And if you doubt that for a second, think what it would be like to be able to read the everyday lives of people in ancient Egypt or ancient Greece. Those mm-hmm. would be fascinating stories for us. And we've missed a part of our heritage, a part of our world heritage, because we can't access those stories. That's why I feel so passionate about helping people to tell their stories. Many times we think, oh, it's just ordinary. Mm-hmm. It's not very interesting.
Who would
it's
care
just
about
me.
It? Mm-hmm.
And it's not. It's fascinating. I'd love to know about the vase, the amphora creator of ancient Greece. That would be fascinating.
Uh-huh. Well, it's nice that you do find that fascinating. I would find it very terrifying, actually, especially if I have not written anything myself. You've written this little book that we're kind of basing this talk on, which is so funny. It's called Storytelling for Pantsers. Storytelling for Pantsers. And one of your comments on the backside said, here's what I love about Annalisa. She is hilarious. And that's exactly what I thought. I'm reading a book on how to write a book or a story or whatever. And it was all so funny and fun. I never thought about it being lighthearted like that.
Well, I believe that it should be fun, uh-huh. right? Writing and telling your story should not be drudgery. It should be entertaining. We should be having a good time doing it. If we're pulling teeth, pulling hair, that's not fun. We don't want to be doing that.
And this book is designed mostly for pantsers. There's another category of writers that I think I fall into. However, you say that you are a pantser. So what is a pantser?
So a pantser is a writer who flies by the seat of his or her pants. And so they're writing over here, they're writing over there. They might start with chapter 1 and then end up with chapter 12. They never quite know exactly where they're headed. And there are a lot of books out there on how to outline, mm-hmm. how to be an outliner. We learned in the fourth or fifth grade
right.
how to outline. We've had that bumped over our heads, but for those of us who have creativity that works in a nonlinear fashion, there aren't a whole lot of resources out there. And I have to say, Sheryl, one of the most gratifying things that's happened for me since this book was published are the people who write to me or call me or just reach out in some way and say, I finally found my home. There is uh-huh. a place for me as a uh-huh. writer. That feels
they
really
gratifying
to me. They
don't feel like an outsider because they don't write the same way.
Exactly.
So you work with both types. Which group is easier to work with?
Neither group is easier to work with. It's really about finding the way that you write and being that writer, and that's what I help writers to do. Now, for the outliners, of course, it's a very straightforward process, mm-hmm. right? What's going to happen in chapter 1? What's going to happen in chapter 2? Mm-hmm. We don't have to think about what the process is as much. Yeah. Of course, we have to think about what the story is, but the process is very linear. For the pantser, the process is what I call a creativity vortex, and I brought a demonstration
okay.
to show you the creativity vortex today.
Okay, let's look at that. Maybe that will help us to understand how we write.
Sure.
Character, clarity, plot,
and pacing. So here we have the main, most important elements of any novel that we're putting together. We certainly want to be addressing the plot. We want to have quality characters.
Right.
We're doing something. We want clarity. We don't want our novel to go all over the place, start in New York City, and suddenly we're in San Francisco. Why? We don't know. And then the most elusive of them all, the pacing. This is what creates that page turner. What's going to happen next?
Uh-huh.
Are they going to fall in love? Is he going to find the golden chalice? Whatever it is that we're looking for.
Uh-huh.
And so, as I said, for the outliner, these are pretty straightforward. The character does this and then this and then this. That's very clear. I've got my pacing. For the pantser, and this is the most important element, it's not a matter of the what, it's the matter of the when. And so this is a demonstration that I use because the pantser, as I said, might start with chapter 1, then jump to chapter 12. And so as they're moving through the process, they need to think about each of these things, but they're going to progress in time. So if, for example, they start at character and move to clarity, pacing, plot, character, clarity, pacing, plot. They're moving through those over the course of time. The vortex demonstrates time where they keep coming back to these concepts over and over and over again. So it's a little more cyclical rather than linear. This demonstration has helped a lot of pantsers to understand what's happening in their mind and be able to feel some structure, to feel a foundation around what it is that they're doing and putting together.
Oh, I see. Just out of curiosity, do more men fall in one category versus women, and how does that work?
That's interesting. In my empirical observations, I haven't noticed one over the other. There doesn't seem to be any real pattern. It's just some people can be very linear in their creativity, and other people have a creative process that's, as I say, much more wonky.
Does, you want to go ahead and sit back down? Do you find that different learning styles constitute whether someone might come near being an outliner than a pantser?
The only pattern that I've been able to ascertain is that people who in their real lives, in their jobs or their home lives, tend to be very linear, in their creative lives tend to be much more wonky. and I don't know if that's a true correlation, but that's what I have observed. And when it comes to the learning styles, we absolutely want to be implementing those learning styles. So Howard Gardner at Harvard University many decades ago recognized that we have different learning styles, right? So there's kinesthetic and there's visual and there's auditory. Tapping into those learning styles is an important part of what I do to help people to find the writer that they are and be their best writer, so that if you are kinesthetic, you know, you should have these things that you're moving around to help you to be a better writer. We do a lot with visual learners, and how do you organize your novel in a visual way? And I have seen some very creative interpretations of how you can visually represent a novel. At the end of the day, we're using all of the tools in the toolbox to get that story out.
Well, I think I read it in this book, or maybe I've heard it, that sometimes outlining can even stifle creativity if you're forcing it on somebody, maybe forcing it on a pantser. Is that right?
Absolutely. And, you know, there are programs out there who say, in order to be a writer, you must outline, you must pants, you must, and there is no must. There really isn't. And it's really about, what do I do that helps me to be in creative flow? That's that state where we're in a childlike play. It feels fun, like it did when we were a kid, to build or to play with our toys.
We weren't inhibited.
Exactly, and that's how writing should feel and can feel, and yet so many writers think that it has to be work, and they have this idea of the suffering artist and all of that. It doesn't have to be that way. It really can be fun. You know, I've written a fun book to prove that writing can be fun. It should be fun. If you allow yourself to be the writer you are and stop listening to everybody's shoulds and musts.
too much information.
Yes.
But this is a fun book, and I was glad that you had written it. And also, I could see myself in different parts of it, and I think other people will find that too. So thank you for being on the show today.
Thanks so much for having me, Sheryl.